Hello, welcome. This week we're going to talk about the hottest news in the emulation world and also analyze several emulators, including two relatively new projects for Android, to see if they are actually worth it for those who have a mid-range device. In addition, we're going to talk about the latest Eden version, 0.0.4, the new Citron update, and also ShadPS4, which recently received a performance boost that can reach up to 100%. First, let's talk about Benji-SC, the Kenji NX, which in turn is a fork of Ryujinx for Android. A lot of people have been commenting about this fork, especially alongside the Kenji NX itself, and some say it's been a game changer on the Snapdragon Elite. But what about other devices? How does it behave, especially on our Snapdragon 8 Plus Gen 1? To find out, I tested some games that already run on Citron and Eden, and now let's see how they performed here. The first game tested was Bayonetta 3, which I already knew would be complicated to run decently, and unfortunately the result was below expectations, with gameplay varying between 15 and 18 FPS, meaning, basically half of the ideal speed. Mario Kart 8, which I expected to have at least reasonable performance, again stayed around 50% of full speed. It's clear that the emulator just can't properly take advantage of the device's resources. Pokemon Brilliant Diamond was one of the few titles I managed to run at 100% speed, but you also can't expect much from one of the ugliest and most flawed games on the system. In Super Mario Odyssey, I noticed a discrepancy in the results. The emulator status showed usage up to 99%, but when checking the native ROG Phone counter, the CPU was only at 40% and the GPU around 20%. Either way, this is another game that delivers very poor performance on mid-range devices. Super Mario Wonder was a case where I really expected to see something better, since it's essentially a 2D game, but the FPS stayed far from the 60 the game requires, and once again the device's resources were not fully utilized. To make things worse, after a few minutes the emulator simply broke, and not due to lack of memory. Finally, Samurai Showdown, which usually gives headaches to Yuzu forks, also showed below expected performance, running close to 40 FPS when the ideal is 60 FPS. As a conclusion, unless you have a Snapdragon Elite, the performance of these forks will fall well below expectations. There are much better options in compatibility and performance, so if your device is mid-range or already 1 or 2 years old, I do not recommend using these Ryujinx forks at the moment. Now moving on to ArmSX2, the new PlayStation 2 emulator that is still in development. The question many people must be asking is whether it's worth switching from NetherSX2 or EtherSX2 to this new project. Just like with Kenji NX, I tested several games to see what it can deliver right now. The Ace Combat franchise has always been problematic in PS2 emulation, and here it was no different. The minimap was completely bugged, particles didn't display correctly, the HUD had issues, and that totally prevents gameplay. So we moved on to Crash Wrath of Cortex, another game famous for being problematic, but recently fixed in NetherSX2. Here, to our surprise, it ran quite decently, without major visual problems and with stable FPS. Speaking of PS2, it's mandatory to test a 2D fighting game, so I picked Capcom vs. SNK2, and no surprises here, it ran normally, without any graphical or performance problems. God of War 2 even gets past the opening cutscene, but as soon as gameplay begins, the game crashes, with no way to make it work so far. I also thought Gran Turismo 4 was at least rendering correctly, but I was wrong. There's a blue filter over the screen that completely destroys the experience, along with broken textures on cars and the HUD, making the game totally unplayable. On the other hand, Need for Speed Most Wanted has acceptable graphics, with only a few minor HUD issues, but the game runs way too slow and ends up unplayable. Need for Speed Underground 2 still suffers from low performance and random visual problems, also impossible to play. Tekken 5, which is great for benchmarking, ran very well through all three gameplay stages, without any graphical issues or slowdown. TimeSplitters Future Perfect, great for people who feel nostalgic about 007 GoldenEye, still suffers from slowdowns and a few small graphical problems. Valkyrie Profile Silmeria, which remains a nightmare for emulation to this day, continues to be difficult. In ArmSX2 it even shows good visual quality, but the game suffers slowdowns depending on the area the player is in. In the current state of this emulator, unfortunately I also cannot recommend it. Even though it's a recent project and already has several games playable from start to finish, it's still better to continue using NetherSX2, which overall will give you far fewer issues during gameplay. As soon as there are new updates about this project, I'll bring everything here for you. Now let's talk about ShadPS4. But before that, don't forget to leave a like to support this kind of content, and if this is your first time on the channel, consider subscribing to follow all the upcoming videos. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. And this month, Instant Gaming is offering a special discount on Wuchang, with a price at least $10 cheaper than on Steam, making it the lowest price ever for the game. What are you waiting for to save? Links in the description. The new version 12 builds of ShadPS4 arrived, bringing important improvements to game compatibility, along with a huge performance boost, reaching practically a 100% improvement in Bloodborne. Among the titles that now open correctly, the highlight goes to Dead or Alive 5, which you're seeing in the background. Even though this game has a PC version, the best port has always been the PlayStation 4 one. However, at least in my experience, I still haven't been able to install any DLC, and the game has sound problems, where voices go silent in several moments. On top of that, random crashes still occur when entering the character selection screen. I also tested God of War 3, which still has missing textures, but the gameplay is already faster and with lower requirements than on RPCS3, although in other scenarios the game remains completely broken. Other titles that now advance more or less in the emulator include Dark Souls 3, Elden Ring, Fist of the North Star, Ratchet & Clank 2016, and some smaller games. Another very important implementation is that the emulator can now save the shader cache. Previously, all cache was lost every time it restarted. To enable this feature, just open the config file in the emulator folder and set the option to true. And the cherry on top of this update was the performance boost ShadPS4 received. In my tests, this boost actually reached close to 100% in Bloodborne. When I tested the game on the previous version, using all effects, 60 FPS enabled, and only a few performance patches, we could barely reach 50 FPS. In the new version, following the developer's recommendation, I capped the emulator at 100 FPS, and the gameplay stayed practically the entire time at the maximum defined value, disabling only a few features from the new patches and uncapping the FPS. It was an impressive jump in performance. As you can see, ShadPS4 received massive improvements, both in performance and compatibility, so if you want to follow this update, just update your emulator. Now let's talk about Eden version 0.0.4 RC3, which finally fixed Pokemon Legends CA. For the game to work correctly, you only need to change the GPU extensions option and set EDS to 1, and also check if Vertex Input Dynamic State is disabled. These options don't fix 100% of the game yet, and at the moment there's no way to run it with perfect graphical quality, but this resolves most of the vertex explosions. The only remaining bug is a few objects flickering, but now it's already possible to play without major issues. Additionally, Ender Magnolia and other Unreal Engine 4 games were also fixed. In my test, Crisis Core Final Fantasy VII, using several mods and enhancements, ran normally, as you can see. Pikmin 4, another game built in Unreal Engine 4, also worked without any major problems. This engine is still a nightmare for Nintendo Switch emulation, but it seems that with every new update, the emulators are maturing. Regression issues present in RC1 and RC2 were also fixed. Initial support for firmware 21 was implemented, and there is now compatibility with Windows running on ARM. In general, this is an extremely condensed log of what was added, since there are dozens of improvements that don't make much difference for the end user. At the moment, I still recommend using Eden nightly, since it receives updates faster than the master version. Citron also received important improvements, and we're going to cover them quickly. The emulator now has specific optimization for Snapdragon Elite, as well as improvements to the shader function on Android and overall better performance. The compatibility list added Little Nightmares 3, and now games requiring firmware 20 and 21 are also fully compatible. Citron's new interface also caught my attention, making Eden and Citron even more different from each other, with better performance and greater compatibility. I tested some issues present in previous versions, mainly to check whether Unreal Engine 4 fixes applied in Eden had arrived in Citron, and unfortunately, not yet. Games like Dragon Ball FighterZ continue to crash randomly if performance mods are not installed. Crisis Core Final Fantasy VII ran normally, as did Pikmin 4, both built on Unreal Engine 4. As for JRPGs, another long-awaited fix, Citron still hasn't received the improvements. Atelier Ryza still crashes before even reaching the main menu, while on Eden the game is already playable. YSX Nordic suffered regression and still has no working audio. The Citron developer also mentioned that the emulator now has an auto-updater. In my tests, the feature does notify when a new update is available, but I still haven't been able to update the program, not even running it as administrator. So, this function is probably still not working correctly. And those were today's news. I hope it was useful. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next video.